Good morning, everyone. I welcome everyone to the 8th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Before we begin, can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place across the Holyrood campus, so please follow those guidelines when entering and leaving the committee room. We have apologies today from Natalie Dawn. Colette Stevenson is attending as committee substitute. As agenda item 1, we have consideration of whether to take agenda item 4 in private. Item 4 is the consideration of the evidence we will hear today. We will also be taking this opportunity to ask members to take 2 other items in private at our next meeting after the October recess. These are consideration of the committee's work programme and the committee's draft response on the Scottish Budget. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. Today at item 2, the committee is hearing from 2 panels. And first of all, we will hear from representatives of Ofgem, the Office of Gas and Electricity Markets, an independent national regulatory authority. I welcome Jonathan Brearley, Chief Executive, Harriet Harman, Head of Transmission Charging Policy, Anna Rosington, Deputy Director Retail Transition, and Stephen McMahon, Deputy Director Electricity Distribution Networks and Cross-Sector Policy, all at Ofgem. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. I would also like to thank you for your written submission given to the committee ahead of today's meeting. Thank you very much. That was a very useful background. And Mr. Brearley, I understand you would like to begin by making a brief opening statement.
Yes, I would. Thank you, Chair. So my name is Jonathan Brearley. I'm CEO of Ofgem. And what I really wanted to do was just to talk a little bit about Ofgem's role and then some of the clearly urgent issues we're dealing with, and just to touch on our wider work programme. So Ofgem here is really here to do 2 things. First of all, to protect customers today, and then secondly, as part of protecting customers, to support the transition to net zero. Now, we have a very strong working relationship with the Scottish Government at all levels. We have over 500 people now working in Glasgow. And that really has allowed us not only to think about things in the UK context, but to make sure we understand the issues affecting Scotland and the concerns that come from the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government. Now, when I talk about our work programme, we are focused fully on those 2 objectives. I'm going to start with the very short term. So clearly, we have seen unprecedented changes in the gas price, and that is putting strain on the wholesale market. And there's 2 things I'd like to highlight to the committee. First and foremost, we are focused on the needs of customers. And clearly, as these costs feed through to bills, that is something that is going to be of concern to all of us. Secondly, I just want to let the committee know that these systems and processes that we have in place are working to reassign customers from those companies that have exited to new companies who can then take them from there. Secondly, though, I do want to touch on our wider programme to net zero. So Ofgem sees getting to net zero as a full part of our objectives. That includes Scotland's as well as the wider UK target. And some of the things I would highlight that we are doing, first of all, we have the price controls, which configures the network so it's ready to receive all the new forms of technologies like electric vehicles and clearly changes that we'll need in the future to heating to make sure that it's low carbon, either through low carbon gas or through electricity. And equally, we are thinking about the charging regimes that underpin that, and I'm happy to expand on that further. And finally, one thing I would say is, given the scale of change that we do need to meet those goals, we do think that there are further reforms to the market that might be needed. We have been doing some thinking on that, but over the coming months, we will be talking about that in more detail. And that's really looking at how do we genuinely not only get to net zero, but make sure we do with an efficient, secure system that is run within customers' interests and at least cost. So with that, I'll hand back to you, Chair.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brearley. Those remarks were very helpful in setting the scene. I would like to follow up on your opening remarks in relation to the disruption in the energy supply market we've seen in recent weeks and the significant increase in wholesale and consumer prices, but both in the UK and across Europe. But obviously, your remit is relating to the UK. It would be useful to get your views on the main reasons for this disruption and how long you think this disruption will last in the UK.
So when you look at what's happening in the international gas market, I think we are seeing a kind of configuration of a number of things at the same time. So first, we are seeing much higher demand than expected from Asia. So if you look at the IEA projections of what was needed versus what we're seeing now, almost two-thirds of the gas that the UK uses has been added to those projections. So there's clearly much higher demand than was anticipated by the market. And then there's a series of factors internationally that are constraining supply. For example, it looks like there is little over and above long-term contracts coming from Russia. And equally, there are some issues with some of the LNG terminals, all of which means supply is constrained and demand is higher than you would expect. And that's really what's driving the price rises that we will see. In terms of duration, it is very, very hard to tell. And you know, our view is we need to be open-minded about how long it might last and plan for a range of scenarios.
Thank you for that. We've also seen the collapse of a number of electricity supply companies in recent weeks, primarily new entrants to the market. As the primary market regulator in this area, do you think tougher licensing conditions should have been imposed on these new entrants to make sure, for example, they were hedging their exposure to volatility in the wholesale market?
So clearly that is something we're going to look at, given the scale of change we've seen in the wholesale market. However, this is not something that is just affecting companies that haven't hedged. All companies in this market are feeling a huge amount of strain given the change in the wholesale cost rise. And just to give you an idea of scale, we are talking a gas price that is six times the price it was last year and went up by 33% last week. So what we Ofgem are doing is making sure our processes work when companies exit the market. And then clearly we will have collectively, we need to have a wider conversation about what this means for the future. But our focus right now really is on making sure that customer interests are looked after.
Final question from me, because I know other members want to come in on this topic. Does Ofgem have sufficient regulatory powers in this area to avoid a situation like this happening again? And with the collapse of the nine energy suppliers in recent weeks, how will you ensure effective competition is maintained in the marketplace while maintaining stability of supply?
So we laid out three principles as to how we would deal with this in conjunction with the Secretary of State and BEIS. And those were first and foremost to focus on customer interests. The second was that we weren't going to bail out companies that were failing. And third, that we maintained diversity of supply. So throughout this, we are keeping a very firm eye on making sure that as the market comes through this, it does have a diverse set of players. And in essence, our job right now is to make sure that we run the industry systems and processes, but of course we're talking to people like the CMA to make sure we have a highly competitive market that comes out at the end of it.
I'll bring in Fiona Hislop shortly. My final question, I guess, is the expected price implication for consumer bills as a result of bailing out the energy supply companies that have collapsed. What will overall, I know there's discussions about a bad bank and how the old liabilities of the failed companies will be dealt with, but overall, is there an estimate on what the impact of this disruption will have on consumer bills?
So it's honestly too early to tell at this stage. We're still working through this and there is still change in the market, and it does depend on the trajectory of that gas price over time. But the main point I would make is, look, with the change like this you're seeing in the wholesale market, there will be an impact that feeds through to customer bills. And just the gas price change alone is something that all of us need to be focused on.
Thank you very much. Fiona Hislop, please.
Good morning, panel. We know historically that transmission charges have caused a disadvantage to development of renewables in Scotland, but bearing in mind you've issued your call for evidence on Scottish locational network charges just on Friday there, and you say within that we do not consider simply reducing transmission tariffs for some parties or in some regions to necessarily be a desirable outcome in its own right, and we expect that charges will be assessed in accordance with our statutory duties, the CUC applicable charging objectives, and the legislative framework in which we operate. So do you consider Scotland a region or a nation? We have a national parliament here. Does the legislative framework in which we operate, does it include net zero? Should it include net zero? How does it include net zero in any changes? Will the legislative framework that you currently operate in include Scottish Government's net zero commitments, or does that require changes? Does that legislative framework in which you operate include the Prime Minister's commitment to 40 gigawatts of offshore wind by 2030? And does that legislative framework include the impending commitment to zero carbon for GB electricity generation by 2035? And if that legislative framework in which you operate is not fit for purpose, when and how should it be changed?
Right. Just to start with our statutory duties. So, you know, our duty broadly is to protect the interests of current and future consumers. And we have been really clear, certainly since I started this role, that we see getting to net zero as a fundamental part of that. So our view has been we're open-minded about whether those duties are changed, but we're not waiting for that. All of what Ofgem does is about protecting customers today and supporting the country to get to net zero. And, you know, the Scottish net zero goal is compatible with all of that. And we are absolutely supportive of getting to that goal. And that does include the commitments that the PM has made. So you've got a regulator that really wants to push forward to make sure that we do meet all of the interim goals to get ourselves to net zero. And again, without going back to the current situation with the gas wholesale price, our view is that one way in which you mitigate risk like this is to diversify that supply base, and that's another reason to get to net zero. Now, all I'd say about our call for evidence on transmission charging is we are opening up a question here. We are thinking long-term about the future, and we welcome representations from all parties, and that's something that I think that we would love to progress. And in terms of why now, I think it is because we do think that we need to reflect on the incentives in the regime as a whole, because the kind of change you need to get to net zero is a fundamental one.
So there clearly is a current tension in the regulatory framework between pursuing net zero and your historic role in relation to consumer prices, and that's a recognised tension. COP26 is going to provide a showcase for investment in Scotland, but your modelling for access and forward-looking charges in your review and your consultation are minded to position, it states, we observe a shift in the location of new generation capacity in our model. Under the transmission reform option, we observe, and I quote, less investment in embedded generation capacity in Scotland and a corresponding increase in distribution zones further south. So is that not undermining the Scottish Government's attempts to pursue net zero in our targets? And how can we... How can Ofgem be sure that building wind farms in England, which is, as we all know, less windy than Scotland, will not make the cost of net zero higher overall?
So, you know, what we are trying to do with the system as a whole is make sure that we have the right incentives in place. So, in a sense, generation is located where it is most efficient to do so. Now, you know, just coming back to kind of the bigger picture here, we are pushing a route that creates huge capacity for Scottish renewable generation. We're talking to the system operator about making sure we have a strategic offshore grid to make sure that offshore generation is able to connect efficiently into the UK. And we are wanting to make sure that all of the renewable capacity, including, for example, in the Shetlands, is something that can be taken advantage of. Equally, as I mentioned, we are thinking about how the market might evolve in the future. We really do make the most of all the different options for net zero, including the benefits as well as the costs of electric vehicles. And that's something that we are trying to work with our charging regimes to make sure the picture as a whole makes sense. And that really does include making sure we have the most efficient way to get there.
Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Can I just follow up on that point? Because we've seen a recent... upping of ambition in Scotland in relation to onshore wind, potentially a target of up to 12 gigawatts of onshore wind by 2030. We've also got the offshore wind target as well, which is sending a very good signal to offshore wind developers. We've got ScotWind coming on as well. Do you not see the transmission charging regime as actually acting as a block to the delivery of that? And how cognizant are you of those targets within the forthcoming review that you're putting out?
So look, I'll pick up, but maybe Harriet wants to come in as our charging expert. You know, my view is this is a chance for us to have a very substantial conversation about how the charging regime plays out. That's why we issued the call for evidence to open that conversation. All I say at this stage is we're open-minded about where that goes, and we are mindful of all targets and all aspirations when we're designing the regime. But I think what we do need to do is to make sure we stick to the goal that we have, which is to get to net zero at least cost for consumers. Harriet, you may want to come in and just provide some more detail about the scope of that review and how we'll approach it.
Yes, thank you, Jonathan. Good morning, everybody. I firstly would just say that I agree with what Jonathan's just outlined. This is the call for evidence that we've put out is very broad, and we are very keen to hear from a variety of stakeholders from within and out with the renewables community, within consumer groups. We want to reach as many different forms of stakeholders as we can, and we want a variety of information to come back to really help us inform what we do next. I think in terms of the current charging arrangements, we've issued within the call for evidence a sort of a bit of an outline of some of the areas that we think there are some questions about. And that's not to say that we have any kind of concluded view at the moment, as you know, this is a list of stuff that doesn't work. It's more to say, actually, these are the sorts of areas that are quite material in terms of the effect they have on the absolute value of charges. And there are some questions about whether they're still the right assumptions, whether they're still the right treatment, whether they're still the right sort of degree of cost reflectivity in the broader context of a very different energy system than we had 20 years ago when the charging regime first came in. And in the context of some of the broader, quite sweeping reforms that we might need to see over the next sort of 10 to 15 years to get us all to our net zero targets, whether that is the UK target or the specific Scottish target. So we are absolutely cognizant of the variety of targets that, you know, that are out there. We are absolutely committed to delivering net zero. The call for evidence will support us in our thinking around how we can utilise the charging regime to not preclude net zero. So there are lots of ways potentially of getting to a net zero system, and what we want is a charging regime that is open to all of them, that would support all of them. And that's really what we're trying to achieve through this call for evidence, is to have people come and tell us, you know, this is the stuff that stops me investing, or this is the stuff that makes it hard for me to compete, or whatever it is that their perception is, such that we can assess actually, you know, whether to the original question, there is a blocker here to the net zero targets or to renewables deployment. So we are, as Jonathan said, really open-minded and encourage a variety of responses.
Yeah, I'm sure you're
right. Just to jump in, the last point is for a while now, I think, in fact, many members of this committee and indeed the Scottish Government and many Scottish stakeholders have asked us to open up this question, and that's what we're doing. So I'm really looking forward to comprehensive engagement. And as Harriet says, you know, we're being as open-minded as we possibly can in our approach.
Okay. I'm sure you're going to get a lot of responses. Can I ask you then? I mean, is it the case that the fundamental problem here is that we've inherited a grid largely from the 1950s, and that all the locational sort of charging, all the locational signals are based around that old-fashioned grid that was based on coal-fired generation? We don't have any coal-fired generation left in Scotland. So, how do you see your decisions and the charging and the investment going forward into the grid that we need that's fit for, you know, the 2030s and beyond, when obviously we're going to have a completely decarbonized electricity system?
Yeah, absolutely. And let me point to some of the work that we've done and that we're working through at the moment to explain how we see this. In a sense, you're right. You know, the grid was designed for the 1950s, it worked really well for about 50 years. And when I started in energy, we still had big fat power stations and people at the end of a line who flicked on a switch and flicked it off. We believe if you look out to 2030, almost under any scenario, actually, you end up with a very different configuration on your grid. So you have much more sort of local generation, you have new renewable generation, but you also have resources such as batteries and storage, which form part of the electric vehicles which are joining that grid. And we think that, you know, the country is facing a choice here. We either try and manage that by building a lot of copper in the ground and by running a fairly inefficient system, or we go to a much, much more flexible system where, for example, we can move demand, for example, changing the times that people can charge their car at nighttime, which will manage the costs both in terms of generation and in terms of investment in the network. But we believe if you do that, you're going to have a much lower cost system. So when we open up the question of transmission charging, that is nested in a wider question of how are we going to make a reality of this smarter, more flexible system that really will bring down costs for customers. And you know, Ofgem is increasingly of the view that it's pursuing that flexible future that is one of the key drivers for a successful transition to net zero, not only to meet climate goals, but also to meet security and cost goals.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mark. Let me bring in Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I have three very quick questions. First of all, do you expect the cost of renewable electricity to fall as more infrastructure is built? And if so, could ultimately renewable electricity become an alternative to gas for heating?
So, look, one of the massive pleasures in my career was starting out sort of with the teams that were in policy terms initiating the offshore wind sector and seeing that at, you know, six times the retail price when it started. And offshore wind has been a case study in how technological innovation can reduce costs and now does compete very favorably, as onshore wind does, with conventional forms of generation like gas and coal. So we absolutely do see that playing a big part in the future of the electricity system. I think what we all need to think through is how we make sure that we have a system that is firm enough and resilient enough to be able to manage the intermittency that's involved. And that's why it's key we pursue options like battery storage and indeed like a more flexible grid that I described earlier. In terms of heating, you know, we've looked at sort of different scenarios for the future, as I mentioned, and one of the key dimensions is precisely how electrical heating versus low carbon gas heating might play out. And we're open-minded on the option. But absolutely, electric heating is a serious option that we should
do. Thank you. Very grateful. Secondly, have you done any modelling or are you aware of any modelling on the financial implications for households from the decarbonisation of transport, buildings, power?
So if you look at the Committee on Climate Change, they have come out with their own assessments of this and they said it's roughly about, I think, 1% of GDP. But that's quite a complex picture when you unpick it. And, you know, what you see, what you do see, in my view, is an increasingly optimistic picture around the costs of the transition for the power sector. As I mentioned, you have a number of technologies that are genuinely continuing down the cost curve, and we have very, very strong evidence for that. But I do think when you think about how we transition in heating, then I think the picture is more complex, and we do need to see new technology and more innovation in that area. And so certainly when you think about it from a household's perspective, those are the two biggest dimensions that you look at. But just coming back to electricity, you know, one of the fascinating things about electric vehicles is really, you know, the cost to run is already very low. And the job of the manufacturers now is to bring down the cost of manufacturing so that we don't have such a price differential between cars. And we're optimistic that that will happen.
Thank you. And given all that you've said, do you take a view, does Ofgem take a view on how the capital costs of that decarbonisation can be paid for? For example, are there other ways other than in the personal bills of the consumer, in the generation and ultimately use of public funds, or does this ultimately devolve on the individual consumer to pay for?
So we think hard about the distribution implications of what we do. And we've set up sort of very granular assessments of the decision that Ofgem makes itself. But ultimately, the question of where it falls, so is it within the electricity system and therefore on bills, or is it something that's taxation, is a matter ultimately for the Treasury and for government. And so it's them who will make that trade-off.
I'm very grateful. I've no further questions, Convener, at this.
Thank you very much. Liam, Colette Stevenson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I would like to focus in on your action plan and your future work programme. And I'll just go for it. It's, how is Ofgem actually engaging with consumers to ensure that there is widespread understanding and a buy-in to the net zero transition?
So we do a great deal of work. I'd say in three areas. First of all, we have direct contact with different consumer panels and consumer groups, and we work hard as an organisation to create links between the NGOs that support consumers and the people that work within the organisation. And I myself do talk regularly to customers. You know, recently I was in the north of England talking about a trial on low carbon gas and how people felt about that. And just to say, that's a fundamental part of my job, because what you realise is, you know, things that you'd imagine are sort of part of the plumbing create quite a deal of concern for people who are involved. And so we need to be very mindful of how people feel about some of the technological changes we might make. Secondly, we clearly talk publicly about all of these issues, and we're engaged in a wider public debate. But we also have a very close relationship with those NGOs that work with consumer groups, particularly the most vulnerable. And what we found during the COVID crisis, for example, was that relationship was key for us to make sure we understood all the different sorts of issues that customers would face over the last sort of year and a half, when, you know, that customers were put under strain in all sorts of different ways.
Okay, thank you for that. And you mentioned about new technologies as well, and better use of data, really, and artificial intelligence. And do you see that as a role going forward in terms of the zero carbon energy system? And really, what work is Ofgem actually doing to maximise those opportunities?
So if you come back to that sort of flexible world I was describing, where you really do need to become more granular in the decisions that are made to turn things on and switch things off, to move the times you might charge batteries, for example, you absolutely need a different kind of platform to support that. And that does mean something that is much more data enabled than the system is today. So we see the role of data as fundamental to getting to that more efficient and more flexible system. Now, we have built up quite a large data team within Ofgem. We have a chief data officer, and we're beginning to think through, you know, almost from first principles, you know, what does that new world need to look like? What are the data requirements, data standards behind it? And therefore, how should Ofgem intervene to support some of these things to happen? So if I were to give you one example, and Steve McMahon might want to come in on this, one of the areas where we do see a big role for data is in those local networks. We're currently in the process of re-agreeing those local network settlements. Data is certainly a part of that. Steve, I don't know if you want to just come in and just talk a little bit about that.
Thank you.
So, Steve, are you online? I think, Steve, you need to unmute Steve, whoever's comparing. There we go.
He's been unmuted. I think that's me. I think that's me unmuted. Yeah, I think as Jonathan said, like, we've got huge changes over the next 10 years or so, in terms of electric vehicles, I think in terms of the way that we heat our homes and businesses. And I think the consumer role in that transition, they'll engage very differently, I think, with how they get their energy. And data is a big part of that. As Jonathan said, over the next 12 months, we'll be settling the next set of real price controls for the electricity distribution networks. We're at the business planning stage with the network companies at the moment, including the two Scottish DNOs that operate the local grids in Scotland. And a key part of our requirements for those networks is, how do we make sure that we transition to a smart, flexible, data-enabled system that can give us real-time information in terms of how people are using their energy, and how the system can then manage that to optimise, I think, the costs, but that we can use more technology to, for example, charge electric vehicles, perhaps when the demand isn't as high, so not at the peak evening periods, for example. So that enabling technology, that investment on network monitoring, data capability, I think more in terms of the distribution system operation aspects, these are all fundamental parts of our price controls and will be fundamental parts of our decisions that we take next year.
Okay, thank you. No further questions, Convener.
Thank you very much, Colette. Mark Ruskell has a supplemental to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Yeah, thanks. I wanted to ask you how you think the smart meter rollout is progressing across the UK, because a lot of constituents get in touch with me and say, oh, I've got one, but it was installed and it doesn't work now. It's really patchy. Some people are able to get them, some aren't. And I'm just wondering, is it best that the smart meter rollout is being done through energy companies, some of which are going bust at the moment? Or is it better that this is rolled out consistently through DNOs, who've got more of an overview about, you know, their distribution and grid in a particular region? Because what I'm seeing is just a bit of a mess at the moment.
Well, Anna, do you want to just come back on the status of the smart meter programme, and then I'll perhaps pick up on the wider point about, you know, who's best placed to make this change?
So the smart meter rollout program is progressing, you know, and, you know, is sort of successful in terms of rolling out sort of a large number of smart meters. I think the key thing is that obviously COVID last year sort of did cause quite significant problems in terms of suppliers rolling out, and that led to the government actually sort of delaying a new framework for the rollout by 6 months. So at the end of this year, a new framework will come into place, which will actually place sort of tight targets on the companies for when they have to roll out and, you know, sort of, yeah, to actually achieve the target rollout. So I think, you know, sort of, it's quite a long way down the rollout program. And I think, you know, government is still confident that the targets will be achieved.
And perhaps just to pick up the wider point about who's best placed to do this. I mean, we are quite far down the programme now. So in a sense, we feel we have a model that will work. Just to explain some of the rationale behind it, you know, one of the issues with local network companies is they don't have the same direct relationship with the customer that some of the retailers do. And, you know, when you think about what you're trying to build out of smart meters, the fact that you're trying to build different products and services that are going to make a huge difference to the way customers can use their energy, particularly when we get to this more flexible world, then we do feel it's right that the retailers are leading that, because they're the ones that really need to be adapting their packages behind it.
Okay.
Thank you, Mark. Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to bring us back to the UK energy crisis, because a report by Citizens Advice published last week found that consumers who are moved to a new supplier typically pay £30 a month more than before. Jonathan, you said that all you do at Ofgem is about supporting the consumer today. Can I ask, how can Ofgem ensure that effective competition is promoted in the wholesale and retail markets while ensuring that ensuring that energy is affordable to all consumers?
Thank you. And Anna may want to come in on the numbers and how we see it. But just to take the main point, all consumers in this market are protected by the price cap. And the price cap does provide a fair reflection of the costs that are in the market. And indeed, when you look at the wholesale costs that are there now, the price cap is providing good value for customers. And so we feel that in these extraordinary times, we do have measures in place that protect customers' interests and make sure that, you know, although these wholesale costs will be passed through, that this is managed in a way that best protects customers' interests. And there are some customers who are on lower tariffs, who are in those companies, that were unable to fulfill those lower tariffs. And we're trying to manage that transition as best we can. I don't know, Anna, if you want to add anything on the specific numbers themselves, but we're working with Citizens Advice just to understand what's behind them.
Yes, I think that's right. And I think, you know, as Jonathan said, supply, you know, so customers were on cheaper deals previously. A lot of these cheaper deals now have been withdrawn with the rapidly increasing wholesale prices, which has meant that actually the price cap, so the capped tariffs, are now tend to be the cheapest tariffs available. And what happens when a supplier does exit the market, Ofgem safety net means that those customers are transferred onto the capped tariff. So they are protected, and we ensure that they are paying a fair price for their energy.
Thank you. I mean, it is a really important issue, because Citizens Advice go on to say that many more people will face fuel poverty this winter and could end up turning off their fridges and freezers, relying on hot water bottles for warmth and requesting more support to buy extra duvets and blankets. So none of us want to live in a society like that. There have been calls from energy companies and charities to introduce a social tariff, which I think is different from what Anna talked about. That would be for those who are already in fuel poverty, which would offer a tariff below the price cap. Can I ask how this could be implemented to ensure that the most vulnerable households are protected from these recent price increases? And also, just more generally, given our interest in net zero, how we can be sure that this journey to net zero won't push households further into fuel poverty?
Yeah, thank you. And look, I think we need to be clear that the changes in the wholesale price are going to be extremely difficult for customers to manage, not just through this winter, but as those prices do feed through to bills later. We do have something called the Warm Home Discount. That is, in a sense, a discount for vulnerable groups against the tariff that's in place. And that is something that I'd encourage all customers to apply for. Equally, you know, we always encourage customers who are facing financial difficulties contact their supplier to get access to a range of support and help that's available. So, for example, if you're on a prepayment meter, there is access to emergency credit. We do have rules in place that means companies have to put you on an affordable repayment plan if you're falling behind in your bills. But my view is we all need to work together, you know, the Scottish Government, the UK Government, Ofgem and the industry, to support customers as best we can for what is undoubtedly a big change in the cost of energy, you know, that's already been in place, but that will undoubtedly cost pressures will feed through to bills later on also.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Monica. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
I'm very grateful, convener, for letting me come back in again. It was just off the back of Monica Lennon's questions. The Scottish Government was planning an energy company. Did Ofgem see those plans? And if so, and in any event, does Ofgem take a view on whether the Scottish Government's energy company would have achieved on the duty of reducing prices to consumers?
So we don't take a view on whether different forms of ownership are going to make a difference to your capacity to deliver for customers. I'd say what our experience is showing that the most important thing is the way that company is set up and ultimately how it manages the transition between the risks that are in the market for the prices that are being paid for customers. And what we do see in the market, even today, even through current changes, is there are a variety of different ownership models that can achieve that. So, you know, we don't take a particular view on the success or otherwise of the proposal that was there, but absolutely we accept that there are different models that can be successful in this market.
And I'm grateful for that, but following up on that, the Scottish Government instead is proposing an energy agency. What impact do you foresee that agency having? Will it achieve all that an energy company could have in both prices and decarbonising the energy system, do you believe?
But I think we'd have to look at the details of that proposal and see how it might work with some of the schemes that we run. So right now is that there are lots of things we need to do, including working on energy efficiency and other interventions to make sure that we manage bills for customers. And we'd be very happy to work with the Scottish Government on their energy agency proposal. I don't have a view right now as to whether that would.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Liam. Jackie Dunbar, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. My first question is going back to what Monica Lennon was raising in regards to supporting consumers, and it made me think about prepaid meters. The customers who are using them tend to get, well, if I'm being quite honest, quite a raw deal with it. So can I ask what is being done to help protect those folk that are on prepaid meters? And is there anything that Ofgem can do about the price to getting those removed? You know, if someone moves into a new property and a prepaid meter is already there, I know it's very expensive to then get it changed back. So I'd welcome your comments on that.
Look, I mean, we have very strict licence conditions on how suppliers should behave to all customers, particularly the most vulnerable. And that's put in some really clear requirements around access to emergency credit, for example, that may tide you over if you are facing financial difficulties. And for all customers, you know, we have requirements that the companies do put you on an affordable repayment plan. In a sense, the other thing I would just add from my perspective before Anna may want to come in on the specifics about removing meters, you know, in a sense, part of that smart meter program we were talking about earlier has been a really, really big change in the prepayment meter market, because that does allow you to top up in a variety of different ways. The last thing I would say in terms of how we're working and how the industry have worked over the last year and a half, prepayment customers did face some of the biggest issues during the COVID crisis. So, for example, if you're self-isolating and you have a meter that needs to be physically topped up, you have to find a way to get help to do that. And I think one of the things that the industry and Ofgem and government working together did really well was make sure we identify issues like that early and find solutions where we can. And that meant working with community groups. In some cases, that meant companies directly sending someone out to support you to make sure you can top up your meter. And if you want to come on the specific point of removing a PPM meter.
So I think exactly as you said, we have strict license rules around all aspects of this. And as you said, the rollout of smart meters is really key in terms of reducing, you know, the cost and hassle involved with PPMs. So smart meters will enable people to easily switch between suppliers to actually pay, you know, pay their bills. And actually also, you know, sort of will make the whole process more cost effective as well. So we'll actually reduce the bills for PPM customers. I should flag two other things. I mean, the cap also applies to PPM customers. So, you know, they are protected. And also if a customer goes, if a supplier goes out of business, the PPM customers are first on our list in terms of people that we are looking after and ensuring that they are transferred across seamlessly.
I think what we're saying is we'll come back with a note to the committee on the specific issue.
Okay, thank you. Just to change the subject again, we've not really touched on hydrogen this morning. Can you tell me what role Ofgem have in hydrogen markets and the hydrogen economy, and what work is it doing to prepare for and to regulate the market?
So this is a huge area for us. It's something that we're highly enthusiastic about. And as I mentioned, when I was talking to that group of customers, it was around hydrogen blending and how they felt just about having part of their hydrogen coming through to all of their heating and their cooking. Equally, I went up and saw a fully hydrogen home and saw how the whole thing can work in practice, which shows you that these technologies are possible. Now, in terms of our role, clearly, ultimately, it is the UK government that will lead in terms of the design of the regulatory regime and the wider economic incentives that would be, for example, applied to generate the hydrogen. But where Ofgem is likely to have a large role will be in certainly making sure the network can evolve. So if hydrogen turns out to be the most cost-effective option, then how we change those gas networks and how we innovate on those gas networks is a really important part of what we do. And equally, something that I know Steve is very passionate about, we have built in a huge amount of innovation funding into these network settlements that we have. And through that, I expect to see a lot of proposals that will be saying, basically, how do we take this to the next stage of development? How do we make sure that we understand at commercial scale what the implications of hydrogen would be, and how do we make sure, if it is the right option, that we have a network that's ready? Steve, I don't know if you want to add anything on the Innovation Fund in general, but it's a big part of our thinking.
Yeah, I think absolutely, and I think it's preparing those gas networks for the transition to a low-carbon future. I think understanding the feasibility, the costs of hydrogen in the gas grid, and I think getting to a position where we have a clear demonstration that the hydrogen network is technically and economically feasible, safe and acceptable to customers. I think, as Jonathan said there, there's a huge amount of network innovation funding that's gone into that. I think last year we had SGN's own H100 project up in Fife, and there's lots more. So I think at the back end of August, we announced the arrangements for the new Strategic Innovation Fund that will apply through the RIIO-2 price controls, and a heavy focus of that is around hydrogen and the heat, I think, challenge more generally. And what we've said is that we can flex the funding that's available to explore those innovation schemes depending on the need and the value for money case for kids.
Okay, thank you. And my final question is regarding COP26. It's just round the corner. Can I ask what your expectations are for it, and what would you like to see coming out in regards to achieving the net zero targets?
Well, perhaps I should talk a bit about the role that we're playing in COP and some of the things that we're doing. So we reached out very early in the process to talk to other regulators and other market operators in across a wide range of countries really to begin to share experience on how we are approaching net zero and really to learn from them. And one thing we're hopeful of, just on a very micro scale, is to build that network out of COP. So we would like to see an international network of regulators created whose sole role really is to share the challenges that we're all facing. So I've spoken to regulators in sort of fully publicly owned systems. I've spoken to regulators in completely different regulatory systems. And what is really remarkable to me is how similar the challenges are that we're facing. I would like to make sure that Ofgem as an organisation is really working with its international partners, not only to spread our good practice, but also to learn from them and to make sure that we can understand where people will undoubtedly have more successful approaches than we do. In terms of COP itself, you know, I'm really hopeful that we continue the level of ambition, not just in the UK, but globally. And I think paradox for me, working in climate and energy policy for sort of 15, 20 years, is it's incredible how far we've come, but it's also incredible how far we have to go. And the risk, I think, is if we don't get sufficient international ambition, it will become harder domestically to continue, but more importantly, we won't get to ameliorate some of the big effects of climate change that we know are there. So I think we've all got two voices, the one that says we've got to push further and faster, but I do think we should recognise that there's been a huge change just to get to here.
Okay, thank you. And thank you, Convener. That's my final question.
That's great, Jackie. Thank you very much. Mark Roskell, please.
Yeah, can I just quickly go back to hydrogen? Are you not concerned that if we put, say, you know, up to 20% hydrogen into the gas grid, we're effectively building independency on natural gas with all the price volatilities that we've seen in recent weeks, and of course all the carbon as well? And we're actually locking in that infrastructure then into the 2030s and beyond, and really high carbon assets.
So look, what we're doing, and with that project in particular, what we're doing is testing and trialing a whole different set of approaches. I do think there's going to be some big trade-offs between low carbon gas and electric heating. And in a sense, what we've got to understand better in both dimensions is the kind of the cost disruption and the infrastructure change that are involved in each. There are different ways of producing hydrogen. So, you know, we have green hydrogen that will come from renewable sources potentially. If you want to sort of pen portraits of where our thinking, but accepting that thinking is evolving, it does seem that for some heavy industry, hydrogen feels like it's going to have got a lot of potential. I think there's an open question about heat and how heating will work. And that's why it's really important over the next few years, we do push that innovation program so that we have a much fuller understanding of the potential and the costs of different fuels. But I do think, though, coming back to the point about, you know, the current situation and our reliance on gas, is that however we do it, we do need diversification. Now, I think we are going to get that in the electricity sector. Remember, that's going to cover a lot of our transport in the future as well.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark. Fiona Hislop, please.
Thank you. I'd like to take you into thinking in the strategic space and in timescale. And certainly, Jonathan, you said that we had to move, you know, the world has to move, you know, further and faster. So that isn't always going to be driven by the market itself. Clearly, legislation and regulation can drive that. So in terms of a time frame here, if we're going to make this shift, what do you see a reasonable time frame is for us to meet the UK targets on climate change and that shift off carbon onto renewables? What's your current thinking strategically?
Well, I think we look to a number of different areas to be able to answer that. I'm just going to check because my internet's gone slightly shaky there. So if it's a silly question to ask, but if you can't hear me, someone let me know you can. Great. So if you know, we look particularly to the Committee on Climate Change around the trajectories that we think we will need. I think it's really clear we need a continued big shift in the power sector. So we do need to see that acceleration in the way that we transition to renewable and other low carbon technologies like CCS, like nuclear. We do need to see an equivalent shift in transport and the government's goals around 2030. We accept that we are going to need millions of electric vehicles on the system to support that. But for me, the biggest question collectively we need to face is this question of how we're going to heat our homes and our businesses. And I do think we need to work hard on, you know, unlocking the potential of the solutions that are already out there as possibilities. And that's where we do need to put continued effort. The one thing I would say is when you look at the scale of that change and you look at you know, potentially more than 10, 12 million electric vehicles by 2030. That's why we need that flexible and smart system. Because if we get that in place, the cost of adding all those vehicles to the system will be a lot lower. And indeed, those batteries provide huge benefits in terms of stability, security, and indeed managing other costs on the system.
So if we're looking at that scale of change, the more infrastructure we have, whether it's in transport, whether it's in heating, in the big areas, the more infrastructure we have, the cost can go down. And it comes back to, therefore, where the generation potential is. And in the Scottish context, you've got a situation where currently the Beatrice wind farm is operating and being charged an average of 4.50 per unit of energy, whereas the similar Gabbard off the southeast of England is £1.50 per unit. So I suppose the issue is that tension that is quite clearly there. Regulation has a part to play. How do we get that infrastructure shift where we can actually get the generation, Scotland's got 25% of Europe's offshore potential. How do we translate that into mass infrastructure for use, clearly in terms of a cost basis for more renewable distribution, if the generation itself is being severely handicapped by the current regime? And I also, if you can answer that, and then I want to get on to, if potential with the convener, what steps in terms of energy legislation and when, because we don't want to miss the boat because we've missed the legislation required to make those changes. So if you can maybe answer that, that'd be helpful.
Right, okay, now can you hear me again? Apologies, my internet is shaky. So I'm sorry, Deputy Convener, just to understand the question, you're asking basically the scale and pace at which we need to reform the system and the charging system around it.
Yes, including the point about transmission as well, because that's clear. And if we miss the boat on changes, how do we get the pace and scale we need for the timeframes that we're talking about to get that further, fastest kind of drive you were talking about?
So my view is there are some very big changes we need to make that strategic step. So, for example, when you think about the transmission system as a whole, and you think about the build that will be needed to support offshore wind, we are strong supporters, as people know, of having an independent system operator that really is going to guide that investment and make sure that we can make that strategic change. That system operator needs to be able to make sure that we have an integrated offshore regime that allows that huge step change we need in terms of offshore wind generation, and indeed begins to plan and to run the system at a more local level also. Now, alongside that, though, that will take time. We need to make sure through our network regulation, and Steve McMahon is leading the current set of price controls, that we have capacity to get the necessary investment in place. And what we did when we designed the first three of these is we said, look, here is an initial allocation of money, so £30 billion roughly. We have designed a process, allow companies to come to us and build more network if that's what they need to do. And so in essence, what we have is a system that makes sure that we can run the system that we think we need today, but also adapt very quickly if we need to build out more tomorrow. And I think you'll find that's played through in our local network settlements as well as our national network settlements. And in that way, we'll make sure the networks can invest in some cases ahead of need to make sure we can hit our net zero target. Steve, would you like to come in?
Thanks, Jonathan. Yeah, I would agree with that. I think there is significant investment that's already happening across electricity networks in Scotland. I think whether that be at the transmission level or the distribution level, we're looking at a lot of grid reinforcement projects coming through, basically so that network constraints do not obstruct the export of power across the country. And I think just picking up on that last point that Jonathan made, we are scaling up the investment ahead of need through our approach to strategic planning, particularly on the transmission network. And I think that's essentially, if you look historically, there has been some issues created in the past where generators had been connected to the grid without the associated network capacity being in place, and with a commitment to sort it out later. What you've got now is the investment is catching up, and in the future we'll anticipate in advance so that network constraints aren't an obstacle. So that's a big feature of the transmission planning. We've got, obviously, the distribution networks, the local grids as well. We're just going through the process of settling those price controls, and we'll take a decision on those next year. But the same principles in terms of making sure that the networks aren't a constraint, and achieving net zero, but doing so in a way that's fair to consumers. That's the driving principle behind it.
And the point about diversification of energy, it needs to be both and to get where we need to get to, as opposed to either or, green hydrogen and others. So how do we know, in terms of a timescale again, that the regulations and the legislation that is needed in advance of these this transition will be in place? And what's your view of when that has to happen to unlock that potential?
So to explain how we think about our regulations, so we do use those scenarios to 2030. We do make sure that we will be building a system that is fit to allow all of the millions of electric vehicles, for example, that need on it. And that really forms a fundamental part of the business planning going through. Equally, the energy bill that is being planned is vital to make sure that we can make the system governance changes underneath that to make sure we have a sustainable system for the future. And so in a sense, what we do is we look to people like the Committee on Climate Change to give us a stake in the ground to make sure we understand how much the system needs to change. And that's what drives the thinking around how we shape our regulatory design and we apply the regulations that we have.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Fiona, I'd like to come back to something Steve McMahon mentioned in terms of consumer behaviour and the concept of behavioural change. What one of the issues raised in by other panel sessions in other committee meetings is the extent of behavioural change required on the part of consumers. I'd like to get your perspective on the main elements, from your perspective, the main elements of behavioural change that will have to happen in the years ahead, and what role will Ofgem play in that?
So, look, I think the way we all use energy, in a sense, will need to change. And as a result, we'll need to adapt how we use our energy and indeed when we use our energy. I think there's a number of different elements to that, but one really is taking advantage of the potential of new technologies that are available. So if I was to give you a very simple example and just explain sort of Ofgem's role in this, if you go back to charging your electric vehicle, we know that if that is done in a smart and flexible way, the consequent costs for the system are much, much lower than if we all simply charge our vehicles at the same time we need to use the grid for lots of other things. Equally, we know that that can be managed in a way that a consumer can still set all of the needs that they have and allow a system to optimize around that through smart charging and through smart chargers. Now, through product standards in BEIS and across government, the government are thinking about how you make sure those standards are applied. That means when I'm a customer, I make sure that not only I get a smart charger, but we have a default set of tariffs set. What we see is our role is in working with government to shape those things, but equally making sure when we do that, that the charging regime and all the costs underneath that really do support consumers to make the right cost. So what I would say is, look, you know, we do need to get the economics right here. But we don't think the economics are going to be enough. We are probably going to need a wider set of behavioural intervention to support customers on the journey that they would make. You know, I point out something in smart charging. The other thing I'd point out, you know, really, you know, one nut we still need to continue to crack is energy efficiency and making sure all of us are doing what we can to prevent our homes from using more energy than they need, both support us in our journey to low carbon, but also reduce bills.
Thank you very much for that. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. So let me once again thank the panel for joining us today. We very much appreciate hearing from you. I think given the range of issues you raised this morning, I think we would very much like to have another meeting in the near future to have a look at some of these issues as they progress. Thanks again for joining us and enjoy the rest of your day. That the committee will now suspend for a changeover of panel. Thank you. go. Okay, fair enough. Good morning, everyone, and welcome back. I'm pleased to welcome our second panel of witnesses this morning. They are Brendan Callaghan, Interim Chief Executive, Environmental Standards Scotland, Tony Rose, former Director of the Infrastructure Commission for Scotland, Professor Ian Docherty, former Commissioner of Infrastructure Commission for Scotland, and Professor Karen Turner, Director of the Centre for Energy Policy, University of Strathclyde. Thank you very much, each of you, for joining the committee meeting today. We appreciate your input. We also thank you for your submissions given to the committee in advance. We have roughly an hour and 15 minutes for this session, and we have a number of topics to cover, so please bear with us while we ask a number of questions of you. The first question I had relates to scrutiny of Scottish Government policy in the transition to net zero. That's one of the main responsibilities of this committee. Your submissions to the committee made it clear that we're looking at a vast number of overlapping policy initiatives and a wide range of targets and metrics that will need to be monitored. And with the best will in the world, we as a committee won't be able to keep track of every single one of those targets. So my first question is to ask what you believe are the key policy initiatives and the key targets and metrics that we should be monitoring, and what policies and targets will have the most impact on shifting the dial towards the climate change targets. And perhaps I could start with Professor Turner, because measurement of policy impact was something, or is something, covered in the net zero principles framework outlined in the submission you gave to the committee. So let me hand over to Professor Turner to begin this session.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you very much for inviting me along this morning. I think probably the core essence of what we submitted in advance is that when we're thinking about net zero, it's a huge transition of the economy and of how people live, how they earn their income, how they spend their income, what things are going to cost to them. And I think what this does is it really raises the issue. I mean, as you've alluded to, that this is a huge public policy challenge. This isn't just a climate policy challenge. It's one that's going to cut across economic policy, social policy, industry policy, and it's trying to bring all these parts together that is so challenging. And, you know, probably particularly in a Scottish context where, you know, we're operating with a devolved government that doesn't necessarily have all the levers and powers in place. So a lot of coordination is going to be required between you know, the devolved nations and the national government. And, you know, we've identified issues around how you really need to understand who ultimately pays for things, how they pay for them and when. And that's a lot to do with, you know, if we adopt an approach where industry has to pay for things, industry will try to pass things on through their costs. So the first challenge then is if prices start to, as we start to incorporate the price of carbon and what, how we pay for things and the price of our consumption, that's going to impact the cost of living. The other issue is that where it's more difficult to pass on costs is perhaps in international, complex international supply chains that many of the firms, you know, for example, at Grangemouth operate in, they can't pass on the prices easily. So if they lose competitiveness, then the cost to households are transmitted in ways of, first of all, workers losing their jobs, reducing their spending and things like that. So this is a very, very complex picture. So I think, I mean, I'm an economist, I'm not a technologist, so I'm not going to pick out the best technological pathways. What I'm concerned about is how we do things in a way that impacts the continued prosperity of the Scottish economy. And ideally, you know, I was one of Scotland's Just Transition Commissioners. We shouldn't be looking just to sustain what we have now. There are a lot of inequalities in our economy and our society. How can we work in ways that start to improve these? So really the metrics that we need to be looking at are the ones that really concern people's lives. So things like jobs, not just the number of jobs, the quality of jobs that we have, how easy it is for people who are at the moment working in carbon-intensive sectors, where I think ONS data has shown that is often a lot of people from low-income households people working in more carbon-intensive jobs. So that kind of accentuates the challenge of ensuring the just transition to make sure that workers can transition. So you're looking at quality of wages, quality of jobs, level of wages, training opportunities for people to be more mobile. So we're looking at earnings as well. But I think there is really a need to keep an eye on what's happening to the income levels, you know, from different sources, not just employment income, what's happening to the income levels of different households. And crucially, while this is obviously a UK metric, what's happening to the cost of living and consumer prices as a result, both of how the green economy expands, but where we're getting costs being passed on. And I think this is a complex challenge. You know, if we think about, for example, if you ask the petrochemical industry to pay more, even in a global sense, what that's going to feed back to is there's so many things that people consume, you know, from their toiletries, from the way their food is packaged, from the way their food is produced, furniture in their houses, all kinds of things. If these costs start to go up, that introduces a wider concern. We've been very vexed with energy poverty, but that is to do with energy bills. When we start to move into a space that prices are going to inevitably have to rise, carbon poverty would cover a wide range of goods and services. So I think we need to always have our primary focus on metrics that concern people's ability to earn a living and what it costs them to live.
Thanks very much for that. Before I bring in other panel members, I just wanted to ask you about the key metrics you covered there. Is there a consensus amongst policymakers in Scotland about what the key metrics should be, what should be focused on, or is that a debate that is still being had? I mean, I get the sense that the answer, without preempting it, is probably the latter, that there aren't yet settled key metrics, you know, 5 or 10, that are central to this and agreed by most policymakers.
Yes, because I think probably you would have a broad consensus and a higher level of the types of things that need to be monitored. But I think you're right. I think there needs to be discussion and debate over actually locking down and tying down what are the specific things that we need to monitor and how are we going to monitor them. And I think crucially, how are we, you know, operating in the devolved context? How do we identify what causes what and what is under, you know, under the control decision makers within Scotland, so that we can, we need to track how things are changing and understand why they're changing. So it's not just a question of identifying metrics, it's trying to identify metrics in a way that they can be tracked and affected.
Okay, thank you for that. Let me ask the same question of either Tony Rose or Professor Ian Doherty on behalf of the Infrastructure Commission.
Who wants to go? You want to go?
Thanks. Kavina, thank you very much for the invitation to speak with you this morning. So I'd like to make some remarks about the transport sector, which is the area that I'm most heavily involved in. I think this is actually somewhat different because we do know the problem we have to solve, and that problem is the level of car traffic in the economy and reducing that level of traffic. So we know at the moment transport emissions are roughly 40% of the overall inventory. Of that, about 40% of the 40% are allocated to traffic. And of course, that number has been pretty stubborn. It hasn't reduced very much, if at all. And given some of the impacts of the pandemic that we've seen, where car traffic is now higher than it was before COVID, and we've seen this explosion in the use of light vans in particular as the economy moves even further towards online retailing, for example, and home delivery, there are lots of trends which are in the opposite direction to that which we'd like to see. So to answer your question directly about the metrics which are crucial in holding the government to account for the targets it's set, I'd point you to the 20% car kilometre reduction target. And we absolutely have to achieve that. And I think it's important to recognise that that target is derived from academic research that shows even if we're able to decarbonise the road vehicle fleet completely because of the embodied carbon in the vehicles themselves, we'll have to do with a smaller fleet in future. So that 20% car reduction target over the next decade or so is absolutely crucial. I'd also say that I think it's important that we focus on the interim milestone targets we have for 2030, because our trajectory to the 2045 targets will be well set by then. And I think there's always the danger of backloading and the assumption that technological solutions will come along in the next 5 or 10 years to fix problems rather than having to do the more politically difficult and behaviourally difficult changes to everyday life, which our carbon targets will require of all of us. And the final thing I think I'd like to say in these opening remarks echoes a point that Professor Turner made about the really key issue of who pays for the process of decarbonisation. And so at the moment, we have a transport system which embeds inequality in the economy and arguably a lack of productivity in the economy because of that domination of road traffic and road traffic in particular places and created by particular sets of people doing particular sets of things. My own view is that we won't get anywhere towards our transport decarbonisation targets unless we have a proper and agreed system of road pricing. I think this is inevitable given the shift away from fossil fueled vehicles in any case, because from the Treasury's perspective, that revenue stream will have to be replaced with something else. But how that happens is both deeply challenging, but also an opportunity to change how we organise the transport system, who pays for different aspects of it, and to more clearly relate who pays to who benefits most from the system. And I don't underestimate the difficulty of doing that for one moment, particularly, again, as Professor Turner says, the issue of pricing remains a reserved matter by and large, and there are ongoing but very stuttering conversations between the administrations, the UK government and the devolved nations on these issues. And in a sense, it's a classic multi-level governance problem where the incentives for agreement are not always as clear as we might wish them to be. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Professor Doherty. Let me ask the same question about key metrics and key policy initiatives of Brendan Callaghan. And Brendan, I appreciate it's early days in terms of the setup of Environmental Standards Scotland, but do you have anything to add to this discussion or at this stage?
Thank you, convener. Yeah, it is very early days, and obviously we're a brand new body and set up by the Parliament earlier this year to help with the scrutiny and ensure compliance and effectiveness of environmental regulations and laws. So it is early days for us, and this area is certainly an area that we can have a role and we can start to contribute. We haven't at our point of setup, we haven't identified an immediate list of priorities, because actually we want to be able to respond to the representations people come to us with and the work of our own an analytical function. Just some quick thoughts on you know, perhaps some obvious priorities, but the climate change emissions reduction targets and Climate Change Act, they clearly identify the main sectors, and you've already heard transport mentioned. I think land use and industrial emissions are the two other areas that I think are going to be very, very tricky to reduce in line with the government's targets, and would be obvious areas to watch on an annual basis to see how the progress, whether that keeps track with the pace that's needed to get to the interim measures and the final 2045 net zero target.
Thank you very much. Professor Doherty, I'd like to come back to one of the matters you highlighted, the target to reduce the distance travelled by car by 20% by 2030, which will require a reversal of, you know, a very long period of increasing car use. You touched on this, but I'd like to get your further thoughts in terms of the behavioural change that will be required to achieve this target. Are we, or are governments doing enough to set the scene? Are governments doing enough to help the public understand why these significant changes in behaviour will be required?
Thank you. I mean, this issue is obviously at the front of everybody's minds because of the scale and immediacy of the challenge of our decarbonisation targets, but it's been one which has been explored in research and literature for several decades now, and so there's the classic question about the balance between what are termed the carrot, so improved alternatives to the car and the sticks, which are making it harder to use the car for some trips, whether that's parking policy or whether that's other modes of pricing. Politicians of all stripes, for obvious reasons, are much more comfortable speaking about the carrots than they are about the sticks. But yet, if you look at the history of our attempts to shift travel away from cars to other modes, the carrots have relatively little impact. And the growth in car traffic has proven to be pretty resilient over the years, albeit with a moderation in the rate of that growth in the 2000s and 2010s. But I think, as I've already said, I'm very worried about the way that the pandemic has the potential to set us back on some of that progress. Because if you look at the moment, public transport patronage is still heavily depressed in comparison where it was before the pandemic. Car traffic is back to normal, to the same overall level as it was the pandemic, in some cases higher, and the level of commercial traffic is higher. So the baseline is very difficult. The direct answer to your question would be no, I don't think there is any government anywhere that's doing enough to prepare people for the level of change that meeting our carbon targets means in terms of how we all travel around. We know what that means, though. We know about the transport hierarchy that starts with reducing the need to travel in the first place. And so there's a lot of really important research being done at the moment to understand what the long-term impacts of the shift to online working, the potential to embed that and to reduce business travel and other trips, which we can substitute by this kind of virtual meeting. We need to understand and mobilise that much better. But we also need to make sure that the number of optional trips that can be made by other modes are maximised. So this is where policy interventions such as the now famous 15 or 20 minute neighbourhoods, where we have to very quickly address the inheritance of our planning policies over the last few decades, where it's become difficult for people to fulfil their everyday needs by walking and cycling. That needs to be a very important focus of government policy in the immediate term.
Thank you very much. A very brief follow-up for me. You mentioned, or my question relates to the relevance of annual targets on the way to meeting the 2030 and the 2045 targets, which are obviously some way off. You mentioned that progress against those targets might not be linear, in the sense that difficult decisions might be put off in the hope that technology and improvements in technology might bring some of the solutions. I wonder if you could elaborate on that in terms of what the implications for public policy and what difficult decisions do you think have to be taken in the next, you know, 1 or 2 years?
I think that if you were to ask most people, most members of the public, about their understanding of the debate so far, they would understand the challenge of decarbonising the transport system as moving to electric vehicles or other alternative fuels such as hydrogen vehicles. The point of the traffic reduction target, as I've already set out, is that we cannot achieve our decarbonisation targets for the transport sector as a whole solely by changing the vehicle fleet. We have to reduce the overall level of travel, and we have to make really radical changes to the modal split of how we travel around. So that means rebalancing the number of trips between the private car, van traffic, public transport and the active modes, walking and cycling. So I really do fear that there's a crowding out process. So a lot of government communication is about the provision of electric charging points, about a strategy for electrification of the vehicle fleet. A lot less of it is preparing people for actually having to change their own personal behaviour and adjust how they make the trips, some of the trips that they have as part of their everyday life. So it means that we'll all have to use, all of us that have cars available to us, we'll all have to use them a little bit less in future, and we'll have to do some more of other things. And again, to answer your question directly, no, despite the best of intentions, I don't think that the scale of that challenge and what that means for each of us as individuals is anything like adequately communicated to the public as yet.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop, please.
Thank you and good morning. I want to focus my questioning on infrastructure. So if I can come to Mr. Rose first, but Professor Doherty might want to come in on this as well. The The issue of the Infrastructure Commission and its view on existing infrastructure and its presumption against new infrastructure was quite a powerful statement. So much focus has been about new building standards or things that are new. So I want to ask you what needs to happen to ensure that that recommendation is delivered, and is the Scottish Government implementing the recommendations on presumption against new infrastructure in your view?
Thank you, Committee. Thank you for the question, and thanks for the invite to come today. In terms of what the Commission recommended in terms of achieving both net zero and an inclusive economy, and in terms of that, it published its infrastructure investment plan early in the year in February, and as part of that, one of the key tenets of that was the investment hierarchy, and that investment hierarchy had looking at existing assets and what you need from them through to then investing in you at the bottom of that hierarchy as a... And so it was encouraging to see that that approach was being taken at a level of principle. I think it's in terms of working practice to get there, it is turning a lot of policy thinking on its head, and that will take time to roll through. But in terms of promoting that recommendation from the Commission, that was a good start in that infrastructure investment plan to articulate that hierarchy from looking at what you already have to you know, there won't be, there's not a need to not build new things, but looking at what you have best is was part of that hierarchy that the government put forward in the infrastructure investment plan.
And does Ian Doherty want to come in on that one?
Yes, please.
You're on.
On transport, we said, or we considered rather, whether we should recommend a complete moratorium on new road building, in fact. So I think there are one or two schemes in Scotland which you can probably still argue would be effective road building schemes if they don't add any more capacity to the network overall. The scheme which obviously, which comes to mind most obviously in my mind is some form of bypass for Dundee, when there are lots of opportunities to reallocate road space along the Kingsway and to do a lot of urban repair and regeneration using better public transport along that corridor. So, unlike, for example, in Wales, we didn't recommend a complete moratorium on road building because we thought that was inappropriate, but we were quite strong to say that what we shouldn't do is promote the idea that we should continue to expand the overall capacity of the road network. So I was very pleased to see that adopted by the government in some recent policy statements about the focus being on the resilience and the performance of the existing network and not its expansion. On the railways, Scotland has gone through a very welcome period of expansion of the railway over the last couple of decades, with notable reopenings of routes and stations. And I think, though, that's going to be much harder to continue given the scale of the decarbonisation challenge that the rail sector faces and the scale of electrification that will be required in rolling stock renewal. So again, I think many people are of the assumption that new railway lines, new stations are going to come along over the next 15, 20 years at the same pace as we've been able to deliver them over the last equivalent period. But I fear that that's not going to be the case because of the scale and the size of the decarbonisation task that's ahead of us on the rail front.
And can I ask a second question, which is mostly about the kind of incentives for building reuse in particular, and what investment or incentive mechanisms are needed to maximise the economic and resource opportunities of transitioning to the circular economy, certainly for materials, but actually for building use. And I wonder, particularly in relation to our experience of COVID and looking at city centres in particular, whether as part of that COVID green recovery, better use or different use of existing buildings can be part of that growth. And what do you think the Scottish Government can do to incentivise reuse of existing buildings? And secondly, would you like to comment on, I think, the consensus in Scotland that zero VAT rating for retrofitting of existing buildings would actually be an economic incentive for recovery as well as reusing existing buildings? Tony Rose, please. Have you got a view?
So in terms of what Sorry, a bit delay on the microphones. Okay. In terms of what government can do around the reuse of buildings, that there are, it's a bit bland, but there are actually some already out initiatives out there in terms of a net zero building standard that's being promoted, and that's a really important part of particularly public buildings, but other buildings. It sets out what you can do to design a building and require of a building to make it get to net zero, and having that in place. You know, a lot of this is new to owners of buildings and others, and having a standard and a guidance that allows them to understand what they can do to get their building to net zero is really, really important. And Ofgem mentioned some of this around hydrogen earlier, around different choices of fuel and use of that and energy. And the hydrogen element is around reusing gas networks. And so that's, it's a complicated process, but actually you need to build in the whole value, asset value of these things, and allow the owners of these assets to see why investing now for repurposing and reusing can be a really important part of their approach. So thinking about that whole life investment asset value and building that in and providing guidance allows them to see how getting to net zero is financially as well as a net zero positive for them is an important part. And there are already moves in place to do that, but there's clearly more to be done on that front as well.
And I don't know whether yourself or Ian Doherty want to say anything about, you know, use of existing buildings in cities, whether that's helpful or not in net zero, or is that just a necessity of life post-COVID?
I mean, I can kick off, and I'm sure Ian will come in as well. I mean, I think from the work of the Commission that the repurposing and reusing of buildings in city centres is a vitally important component of what we're seeking to achieve here. As COVID has sort of accentuated that requirement, if people aren't working in cities as much, repurposing those assets and making them places to live, or making that environment in city centres to be more viable from a living and working combination is vitally important. So I think there are already trends around offices that aren't maybe being as used as much being repurposed into residential dwellings, and that does two things. It enhances the city centre as a living place, but it also means that you are repurposing those assets rather than knocking them down and rebuilding them. And there are good examples of that happening already in the country. So I think it's a really important part of what the Commission was saying, and COVID has almost accelerated the kind of implementation of that.
And Professor Doherty, I'm conscious people are not biting on my VAT issue, but there you go. So Professor Doherty.
I wasn't aware there was a consensus on the VAT issue, but I think that for me, it's by no means my area of expertise, but the gradient between the lack of VAT on new builds and the application of VAT to the materials it's used to refurbish existing buildings is a long-running issue, and I think I'd certainly be in favour of doing something about that. On the transport and cities front, I think I'd say a couple of things. It's a truism that for probably as long as we've measured these things, so for a century or more, we travel around more or less the same time that we've always done, and we travel around the same time to do the same things that we've always done. But as transport technology has improved, we've traveled further to do the same things. So this is what you've seen of decades and decades of net decentralisation from cities as the car has become an ever more dominant part of the overall mobility mix. So therefore, it's obvious that if we want to reverse that, and if we want to reduce the level of overall car traffic we have and therefore emissions from transport, that we should reverse that. So if we're going to continue to spend the same time travelling to do the same things, then we have to travel shorter distances and reusing buildings in city centres or town centres where the majority of services that people rely and depend on are easily available to them by walking, cycling, public transport is pretty much as close to a no-brainer in a policy sense, I think, as you can find. However, and this comes back to the point about pricing that I made earlier. Yeah. I'm really concerned about the potential for a renewed gradient between how we price and how easy it is to travel around and access city centres versus suburban and out-of-town service areas. So city centre footfall, we know, has collapsed. We know that that's driven by a lack of public transport commuting, and we know that's because the people who are most likely to have used and particularly the rail network to access city centre jobs are those that can do them from home. So I think the research based on that now is quite well established. And of course, we wait to see how the rebound of that will unwind over time. However, as long as we we still fail to price properly trips like taking your 4x4 from a suburban location to an out-of-town shopping centre, and creating that kind of traffic as a double whammy for existing town and city centres. We've been concerned about that in academic research and in the professions for decades. I think that the risks now of us desperately trying to reinvigorate our town and city centres whilst even more of that activity graduates to out-of-town retail and service centres now, with all the implications that has for equality of access for people that don't have a car, I think that's going to be a really difficult short-term problem that bold policy interventions and, I would argue, pricing are going to have to address.
Thank you.
Thank you, Fiona. Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Yeah, thanks. Morning to the panel. Can I start with Professor Doherty? And I wanted to ask you about your report into the future of rail post the pandemic. I mean, it remains quite controversial because I think one of the recommendations in there was that there should be a reduction in revenue requirement. And clearly that has raised alarm bells with staff unions and those who are concerned about cuts to services that may come on the back of that. I guess I wanted to ask you about whether you see a reduction in revenue requirement as being compatible with designing a rail service which is competitive with private car usage. And if I could just give you a very quick example of that, I held a public meeting last week where ScotRail were telling the public about the proposed changes that they want to make to the rail timetabling, and it's arguably, you know, this has come on the back of your recommendations to government. And they described the Perth to Edinburgh rail service as effectively not being competitive with the private car. And they were describing how, you know, you can get across the M90 and the Queensferry Crossing cheaply. So their response to that then is to effectively say, well, in that case, it doesn't really matter if we increase journey times because very few people are using that rail service anyway. So I just wondered if, like, what your thoughts are on, you know, the compatibility of reducing that revenue cost with maintaining competitive services, and is there not a danger that if we cut too fast, too hard, then effectively we just end up with a service that people are not going to use anymore because there's nothing left to use?
So thank you for the question, and thank you for the opportunity to discuss the report. I should say I'm flattered by the attention it's generated, and if only I had that level of direct influence over the decisions of ScotRail. I'd like to point you to two things about the report. So one, it's based on the evidence that myself and colleagues have been collecting as part of a very wide cross Great Britain research project on the impacts of COVID on travel behaviour. And that study will continue for another couple of years now as we seek to better understand a lot of the longer term trends, and particularly the impact on public transport as it's reflected in this report. One of the key recommendations I made in this doesn't seem to be picked up, of course, in the dash for a headline, is that there is no credible decarbonisation pathway for transport that I can see that doesn't involve a very much greater level of use of the railway in Scotland than that which we had before the pandemic. So in the report, I made some guesstimates about what the scale of that increase might be based on what might be seen as achievable shifts from the car to other modes, and also from the from physical transport to online meetings or home working. And the headline there is, I think, that it's reasonable to assume that we should plan for a doubling of the number of passengers on the railway as opposed to pre-pandemic. I think if we plan for that, then we can get towards net zero and the decarbonisation of the transport system. So the question then becomes, as you rightly point out, how do we, it's effectively a kind of bridging challenge, isn't it? It's how do we get from this crisis situation we have now, where railway patronage is still only about half what it was before the pandemic, and revenue also is roughly about half what it was, to a system or situation rather where patronage, perhaps not revenue for reasons I'll come on to, but patronage is double what it was before. So it's a bridging issue. I think there are some difficult issues that the railway industry, and by extension ministers who fund it, have been grappling with, again, that haven't perhaps had the airtime that they might deserve. So first of all, the rail network isn't actually used very much. and particularly where we have a lot of expensive rail networks. So again, pre-pandemic, even in the Greater Glasgow suburban network, which is often lauded as being, you know, the best outside London in the UK, et cetera, something like, you know, I think it's fewer than a half of all adults use the train once a month. So we have this asset which is grossly underused. And the main reason it's grossly underused, and again, I point to this in the report, is because of the different level of pricing. And back to the question that Professor Turner raised earlier on about who pays for the transport network. Frankly, driving is too cheap. Public transport tickets are too expensive and too complex. And that's the reason that more people don't use the railway. So I would argue that's the root cause. And if we want to really address patronage recovery on the railway, given all that we've talked about the decreased activity in city centres, et cetera, we will not do that to the extent that we require to do if we don't get a grip of the pricing structure across all modes of transport. And that means who pays. And that does come back to this core issue about how we price car travel, because I think just about everything depends on that. Mm-hmm. I don't envy people in ScotRail or ministers. Part of the problem with service reductions that the operators are grappling with, of course, are the direct operational impacts of the pandemic and what that's meant for the availability of staff, in particular drivers, and the suspension of driver training, and a whole set of difficult operational issues, which again don't tend to make it into the media. One thing I would also say is that the rail network as it stands now has only had so many services, so many seats, and so many people employed in it for relatively a very short period of time. So even if you go back to the start of the current franchise period, and I've looked up some of the statistics here to make sure I get this right. Since 2015, we've had a 4% increase in passengers, about a 20% in seats, an 8% increase in the services that were run on the network, and a 22% increase in government support for ScotRail. So we've been spending a lot more money for not very much more in terms of service output. And so I don't think that a recalibration of the ScotRail timetable is necessarily as much of a difficulty across the network as a whole as is being made out. Now, of course, I understand that there are differences in different routes and particular users whose services are affected. And that, of course, is true. And the final point I'd make for perhaps follow-up questions is that ministers are in a situation where we have a devolved financial settlement, and unless somebody has changed the legal basis of Scottish parliamentary spending, and we've all become modern monetary theorists overnight, the budget still has to be balanced, and the revenue budget across all public services, of which of course rail is effectively one, even in advance of the nationalisation of the operating company, ministers have a budget to spend on public services. And if you look at how much the railway costs now for the relatively small number of trips it provides now in comparison to the pressures that particularly the health system is under, I think it's entirely justifiable, and indeed I would expect ministers to open up the question about where value for money across those public services is best found. Now, that's a really difficult set of questions. And yes, that does shine a light on the very large revenue support that the rail industry has enjoyed, increasingly large support over recent years. And these are really difficult political questions, and that's what you see played out in the media every day. But I think it's very healthy that at long last, we're actually having that conversation.
Okay, thanks. Can I ask you, in terms of revenue income, I mean, your own research that you're involved in is pointing to the fact that we might not know what rail patronage is going to look like for another 12 to 24 months. I'm just wondering if now is the right time for ScotRail to be doing a timetabling review when we don't actually know what that long-term trend is going to look like. I mean, I'm on the train every week, and I kind of marginally see a few more people coming on each week, but it's not really clear if it's going to go back to the kind of levels of patronage we saw pre-COVID, which were, well, the trains were completely packed.
Well, again, I have no responsibility for setting the timetable, and so, you know, I'm lucky enough to be able to write a report and give some advice and appear at meetings like this, which I hope that colleagues in ScotRail will listen to. I think they've said publicly that the timetable recalibration which is underway, is a new baseline, and that services will be added to that as patronage recovers. I think we'd all welcome that. But I also would say that I wouldn't underestimate the operational difficulties, particularly ensuring that the availability of drivers, given the hiatus in driver training, which they've experienced over the course of the pandemic. There are some pretty difficult operational decisions which engineering and ops colleagues in the railway industry have had to deal with over that period. And so the timetable recalibration is a really crucial and difficult and controversial process. Yes, but it's driven by a whole set of complex variables, one of which, of course, we haven't mentioned yet also is reliability, because we know that the reliability of the railway service is perhaps equally as important as frequency to many people. And again, pre-pandemic, the predecessor to this committee spent a lot of time looking through the reasons why punctuality on the ScotRail network had fallen, as indeed had happened in many systems, many operators across the GB network. And the answer to that was that we were trying to shoehorn more and more and more services on an infrastructure that really couldn't cope with them. So in many respects, I think this is the ideal time to be doing this. Again, though, I would agree that does open up some really difficult questions about the impacts on individual routes and value for money. And I would say that the bringing in of the operating company into the public sector is going to shine an even stronger light, I think, about the value for money that we get from the railway network as it's currently contributed, what the opportunity cost of not spending that on other aspects of public services are. And of course, that's the way that the annual Scottish budget is formulated. As I'm sure you all know, that when you're requested to make proposed changes to budget, you have to think about the impact on other spending lines across the responsibilities of the Scottish Government. And I think that's a really healthy debate for us to be having. And again, I'd say the most important discussion we've got to have as a result of that is about how the overall transport system is funded, who pays for it, and what that then tells us about how well it serves our communities.
Yeah, thank you. We're certainly debating it intensely at the moment. Can I move quickly on to ESS and Brendan Callaghan, something completely different? I mean, obviously, you know, as an organisation, you've now got your draft, your interim plan, strategic plan going forward. I wanted to ask you about whether there are some key areas that you're going to be focusing on in the next year. I'm aware that there are particular concerns around the marine environment, compliance with existing laws and regulations, the adequacy of some of our laws, particularly in relation to salmon farming and to fisheries licensing. And I'm aware that there are complaints that were in with the European Commission ahead of Brexit in relation to acoustic deterrent devices, for example, in the marine environment, which presumably now will go nowhere. So I'm interested in, is that an area which you're really focusing in on, or are there other areas which are problematic in terms of compliance and the adequacy of our existing laws and regulations?
Okay, thanks very much for that question. I would stress it's very early days for us. We established as an organisation on the 1st of October. So we haven't taken any formal decisions about the topics we'll be investigating at this point. However, marine and the wider concerns about the regulatory environment there, that is something that's been brought to our attention in discussions, in formal discussions we've been having with a range of bodies so far. So it is one that we're, I guess, at a pre-investigation stage of looking at the wider circumstances around that and start to understand if that's something that we could look at. In the development of ESS over the last 6 to 9 months, we have made our presence known, and we have been starting to establish these early relationships. I think where we're actually at is a lot of bodies have their concerns about a range of matters, and they're probably keeping their powder dry until we're actually here and we now have our powers and our formally established. So we're starting to get a stream of inquiries and a stream of issues coming to us, and as I said earlier in my introduction, it was a conscious decision that we didn't want to arrive to say for the first 6 months this is what we're going to be doing. We still really putting in place our capacity, and we want our early focus to be informed by these discussions with expert bodies and the issues that people come to us with. So, you know, we've been talking to bodies, Environment Link, RSPB, the Coastal Communities Network, and they've been flagging a variety of issues that we're going to start to be sifting through and considering where we put our resources.
Okay. And just can I ask you just finally, in terms of your relationship with the UK Climate Change Committee, it was something that we discussed a lot during the passage of the Continuity Bill and how that was going to work. How does that look now? I mean, do you have a memorandum of understanding? Are you clear where you can work together and where you have discrete responsibilities?
We're absolutely heading for a memorandum of understanding. We've had a formal meeting with them to discuss how this might work. We know their input and responded to the consultation on the draft legislation. It's looking actually like a very productive relationship. I mean, you know, they have a role as an advisor. They're experts. They do research and analysis and the role of and climate change policy. We have a role there, but we also have the powers of compliance and enforcement. So we'll capture that in a memorandum of understanding over the next couple of months, which will be on our website. People can have a look. But essentially, we want to avoid duplication. So we're not going to be doing research or analysis in areas that they're working on. But we want to be able to feed off the work and the issues that they identify. So they might be advising government on the one hand of problematic areas or areas where progress has not been made. But that might be useful for us to identify areas where actually behind that there's lack of compliance or there's an ineffective law that we could perhaps take action and investigate with the authorities concerned.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. Liam Kerr has a brief supplemental in this area to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Very grateful. Thank you, Convener. Mr. Callaghan, on the powers of enforcement that you mentioned, I think I'm right in saying that the ESS cannot impose fines for breaches. So the question begged is, does the ESS have sharp enough teeth?
Well, thank you. No, we can't directly impose fines, but we do have, for example, if it was a straightforward matter and we issued a compliance notice, I mean, we would actually hope to be able to resolve these matters through dialogue and through agreement with the public authorities concerned. But if we issued a compliance notice, for example, requiring them to change the procedures or adopt a different approach, and they didn't comply with that, the legislation gives us the ability to go to the Court of Session, and the Court of Session can either require that those actions are implemented, or they can treat their matter as a contempt of court. So in that situation, I guess fines or other court action could ensue. So actually, we think we do have teeth and we do have adequate powers, but, you know, time will tell, and you'll obviously be able to see yourselves how that goes.
That's very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Liam, Colette Stevenson to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I wanted to talk about or ask you some questions around adaptation. Obviously, adapting to climate change, you know, regardless of how swiftly our emissions are cut, or hopefully are cut as we go forward. And I think I'd probably draw on Karen on this, is what are the costs of actually adapting and becoming more resilient to climate change? And how do you think these should actually be borne?
Yeah, thanks for the question. I mean, I'll say up front, you know, most of our work has been looking so far at the cost of mitigation rather than adaptation. But I think, you know, the general question of how should the cost be borne, I think the challenge here is that, you know, kind of as I mentioned earlier, you know, that there's often a kind of modelling where, you know, like a polluter pays model. So you see a way that's often thought as the kind of moral or the appropriate way to pay for something. The problem that we have, though, is that wherever people or bodies can, they will pass on costs that they're having to bear. You know, so you know, if you charge a polluter, you'll see their prices going up, and you know, so, you know. I love watching people on the television when different issues come up. And there was a guy a couple of weeks ago at the petrol pump saying, well, we end up paying for it, whatever happens. And I think there is a heavy dose of truth to that, you know, that you have to be careful and it's about the distribution. So you have less control when costs are passing indirectly and they're going on to consumer prices. And I think that's what often brings the argument back to, do you need to look at taxpayer burdens? Because then it is more controllable over who is ultimately going to pay for things. And particularly where I think there really needs to be concern over the people who are least able to pay for things carrying too much of the burden. And there are concerns there where you do taxpayer burdens that we've seen through the COVID crisis, you know, that whenever better off people are spending less money, the people whose jobs are at risk are the lower income people. And that's something you always have to caution about. So I think before you ask how should we distribute the burden, we really have to think about what are the outcomes that we're concerned about. You know, so this, you know, going back to the just transition, where do we want different groups in society to be at the end of all of this, with particular concern over those who are less well able to pay? But I think general, you know, for citizens who are also electorates, that they are going to be content with whatever happens here. I think that's where we need to start. We need to ask the picture, what do we think we want our net zero society to look like? Where, yes, we're going to have to pay more. We have to think about how that's going to be distributed. And then we have to backtrack that up to, right, we've got stuff to pay for. How are we going to make sure that that's paid, that we get to the outcomes that we want? So I guess it's kind of, I'm hearing a lot more of this kind of theory of change. And I think we really need to start applying this where you look at your outcomes. You know, Scotland has to, and Scotland will have, it's a different electorate, it's a different society to other parts of the UK. We really need to look at what do the Scottish people want the Scottish economy and society to look like when we get to net zero. And based on those outcomes, that's how we need to figure out how we're going to pay for all of them. Because if not, the law of unanticipated consequences might mean we have the best intentions for how we set things out, but how the costs are ultimately passed on through various mechanisms in the economy can give us outcomes that are not desirable and will ultimately equate to a transition that is not regarded as a just one, because that is the key thing. Academics like me can sit down and say, what is the just transition and define it? But at the end of the day, the transition will only be just if the people have viewed it as such. So I think we really need to start with where do we think we want to be? And that's perhaps a bigger, wider debate. But we've got COP26 coming to the city. Rather than having a public debate about, you know, with apologies, because all these areas are important, about cars and emissions and how you heat your home, why don't we have a debate about and a discussion about what we think we want this country to look like when it's net zero?
Okay, thanks, Karen. That's a really interesting response. Can I pose the same question to Brendan Callaghan as well? Thank you.
Thank you. Well, we can potentially have a role in terms of adaptation. We obviously have to have an eye on Environmental Standards Scotland, an eye on what the legislation requires and the role of public authorities in delivering that. So that, I don't have an awful lot to say in this one at this stage, because that's something that we'd need to look into quite a lot of detail as to where could we use our powers and our role to influence this. Now, for example, if a matter was drawn to our attention about the unfairness or the lack of a just transition on something, and we identified that was essentially the law was being ineffective and having an unintended consequence, and it was broadly an environmental law, then certainly we could either go to that public authority or go back to government and draw that to their attention in quite, you know, shine a light on that in quite a formal way. So that's probably all I need to say at this time.
So, and just finally, thanks. Just finally, it's with regards to the actual publication of Scotland's adaptation programme in 2019. Where has the most notable progress been made so far, and where are the areas of greatest concern? And I think I'll ask Ian Docherty on that, I think.
Thank you. I think what I'd point to there is something I said earlier on, which is perhaps the built-in expectation that we will continue to build as much new transport infrastructure as we've been able to do over the last 15 to 20 years. So we've already seen the impacts of climate change on the transport network. So the best to be thankful is the obvious example. And of course, it remains to be seen what the final outcome of the inquiry about the derailment at Stonehaven were. But there's another example of extreme weather events, which we expect to become ever more commonplace as climate change unfolds and the catastrophic impact that can have on infrastructure failure. So I'm very taken by something that Professor Turner said there about the transition will only be just if it's seen to be just in the court of public opinion, as it were. And again, I'm not sure that we're all ready for a period of the redirection of resources much more towards increasing the resilience of our existing networks rather than building new ones. Again, that shift has been long talked about in the analysis and the academic research on the likely futures, but I don't think that's percolated through to the public debate yet. So when you add together the fact that a lot of our infrastructure remains aged in the first place, so it's up for major renewals, and there's a debate about the structures on the M8 through the centre of Glasgow that are 60 years old now, and the long-term future that they might have. So you've got the existing fragility of the infrastructure, how it will need to be made more resilient for increased extreme weather events and other implications of climate change. And then on top of that, the requirement for decarbonisation through electrification of either vehicles or the fixed network. When you set out that kind of sequential set of requirements, I don't think it's hard to see that we won't be building as much new kit as we've done in recent years. But again, I'm not quite sure the extent to which that has made it into the public understanding of how our public expenditure choices by necessity will have to change over the next 15, 20 years.
Okay, thank you. No further questions, convener.
Thank you very much, Colette. Monica Lennon, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel, and good morning to Professor Turner's cat, who made a nice appearance a moment ago. Can I return, Professor Docherty, to your report? Mark Ruskell's asked some questions already, and I think you were very modest about the attention the report received, some of the headlines. After all, you are a former non-exec director of ScotRail and Transport Scotland, so you are a person of influence. But your report is right that Scotland's rail network has a central role to play in meeting Scotland's climate change targets. And I think you also made the important point about, I've lost my notes here. Yes, what you said about making that shift from the car to train. What I'm not sure about, and I think this is where the public really are confused, is if we're going to try and meet those climate change targets, how will the proposed service cuts, proposed closures of ticket offices and job losses help with that? Surely those kind of measures will make it more difficult or will make people feel less safe, less secure, and that it's less accessible to them and run counter to the race to net zero. And I just wonder alongside that, because there are concerns about the quality impact of some of these proposals. We're hearing a lot right now in the media about women's safety, but also I hear a lot about the rise in hate crime towards disabled people, towards people of colour on our railways. So if we want to affect behaviour change and give people the confidence to get on the trains, how will all these cuts help with that?
So Thank you for those comments. These are complex issues, so I'll try and piece my way through them. So if you take any reduction in service quantity or quality in isolation, then it's obvious that that is likely to have a difficult impact on people that depend on the service. I don't think anybody's arguing that that's not the case. But there's some really crucial context here, I think. First of all is that we've had a massive growth in the proportion of public expenditure allocated to the railways in recent years, and indeed the numbers of trains that we have. So a modest retrenchment in the overall numbers of services, it's not as if we're going back to the 1960s or 70s in terms of the overall level of service provision. We're going back to probably where we were in 2015 or 2016, with about half the number of passengers. that the network would have been expected to have. So those are the facts, and you're absolutely correct to say that they present some really hard choices. And hard choices to me are always about opportunity costs. So I come back to the point about what would we expect our ministers to do with the public expenditure that they have available to them, and what are the best outcomes for the public that they should expect from those decisions. Now, I've been quietly warning in public events and also within those roles that you identified I've held in the rail industry for many years now, that at some point the kind of relentless growth of the amount of public expenditure allocated to the railways would come to an end, because nothing is forever. I didn't expect it to be COVID, as I don't think anybody expected the pandemic to be the exogenous shock that delivered this, but it was a fair assumption that at some point that continuous growth in the resources available to the network would slow or stop or reverse. So in many respects, we're dealing with the consequences of that now. I understand exactly what you're saying about the equalities aspects of all of this, and personal safety, and the general quality of the experience of being a traveller on the network. These are issues that are common to every equivalent railway network across Europe and the world. There are a set of choices about how resources are deployed to meet them. Our network hasn't changed very much in comparison to many equivalents across Europe. It's still a traditional heavy rail network, crewed in a way which looks the same as it's done for a long time, with stations that look the same as they've done for a long time, with ticket and retailing options that by and large look the way they've done for a long time. Lots of other equivalent railway networks in Europe have made different choices to modernise those and have better outcomes. And one thing I would say about safety is that by far the best way to improve the safety for people that use the network is to have more people travelling on it. So then we have to come back to the root cause of all of this and how we get more people travelling on the network. So I think in summary, I would say that, of course, I understand all the concerns that have been raised in response to the questions which I think need highlighted and need discussed. The impacts in terms of the attractiveness of travelling by train that what ScotRail's proposing, if they're enacted, and let's assume that they are as negative as you put forward, they are absolutely dwarfed by our inability to get to terms with the low overall use of the railway, and back to this question about who pays, and the fact that we have set up the fiscal structure of the network and encouraged behaviour, and making this more so now post-pandemic, that means there are far too many people using cars when they could be on a bus or in a train. And I come back to that statistic, which I have to say shocked me when I heard it the other week, about a minority of adults who are in the part of the country covered by our best railway system have used it once in the last month pre-pandemic. If we're going to fix the service quality issues, which everybody's concerned about, we have to have a step change in the use of the network. And that requires, you know, really far-reaching, I think, questions about whether it's fit for the travel patterns of the future rather than the travel patterns of the past.
Thank you, Professor Docherty. I found my notes from earlier when I was scribbling down what you were saying in response to Mark Wiskill, and you talked about having a plan for the doubling of rail passengers. I'm not sure if that plan exists, but I'd be interested to hear what you think it should include. But just going back to public confidence and public mood, because clearly during the pandemic, people were advised not to use public transport. If they were travelling by car, not to car share. So how do we, in terms of public messaging, try and shift that advice? Because I haven't really heard a lot of new advice to tell people to get back on the bus, get back on the train. We're seeing, obviously, morale very low amongst key transport workers, including rail workers. We're seeing industrial dispute. We're seeing possible strikes increasing during COP26. How do the Government, Transport Scotland and ScotRail and trade unions cut through all of that and try and find some agreement so we can get the travelling public back into public transport and out of private cars?
Okay, thank you for those questions. I've tried to scribble some of them down, so please forgive me if I miss some, and I'll try and go through them. So myself and colleagues involved in the Transport and COVID Research Project have already published some of our outcomes on this, both from our household survey work, which is undertaken in 10 areas across Great Britain, some of our focus group work and our interviews with key decision makers across the transport sector as a whole. We have a quote in one of our academic papers and from somebody south of the border, senior representative of one of the key organisations of the transport sector, expressing his bewilderment when he heard the Prime Minister in one of the early COVID briefings from Downing Street articulate the message of avoid public transport. You know, so for that person's entire working career had been based on trying to achieve this modal shift between the car and public transport that we talked about right at the beginning of the session in terms of the carrots and making the service better. And then he argued or felt like decades of that work was being undermined in an instant. So I don't underestimate the impact that that's had. And indeed, we're trying to do some work in our forthcoming survey waves to really understand that better. In passing, I think it's worth saying that Transport Scotland tried to have a slightly different message about keeping the public transport network open for essential users. We could probably discuss all day the extent to which that was successful, but again, I have academic colleagues elsewhere who are doing some work about messaging across COVID and its impact on behaviour. What we have found in our work thus far on the upside is that we haven't found much evidence yet of switching away from public transport to more car use because people are uncomfortable, either because of the direct impacts of the virus or of the safety issues that you mentioned. What we have seen is that the people who are most likely to commute by train are most likely to have jobs in city centres best served by rail and most likely to be in the kind of jobs where traditionally rail commuting has done well. The same thing is true of cycling, interestingly. So the number of people commuting by cycling in proportionate terms in our survey has fallen again precisely because those people tend to be in jobs where it's easy for them to work at home or with a laptop in a cafe or whatever. So there's a kind of set of self-selecting process that's going on. On the downside, what's happening is that people have got more flexibility in terms of time when they're at home. So, for example, if I'm sitting at home now rather than in an office somewhere, if it rains at 3 o'clock and I decide I want to pick the kids up from school rather than get them to walk home, I'm free to do that because the car's in the drive. So if you look at the traffic use statistics, what you see is that we've had a reprofiling of what kinds of trips are happening. And again, this is why I said earlier on that I worry about these behaviours that are being embedded and that we've created almost by accident a kind of, or default, a more North American view where daytime car trips, more school run, more driving to the shops rather than walking to the local corner shop, etc. These things are now more possible for more people because we are not sat in offices somewhere else away from the home. So there's a whole set of really complex behavioural changes there that we have to understand better and we have to try and unwind because they're contrary to what we're trying to achieve. On messaging and how we move forward,
it looks like we have a brief technical issue. Okay, we're back. Professor Doherty, you cut out slightly there. If you could repeat your last, perhaps, couple of sentences, that would be great.
Oh, sorry, I just moved on to the issue about messaging.
Yes.
As we move forward and how to recover patronage. So clearly, this is difficult because the lack of use of public transport is driven by economic imperatives for people who would otherwise have used it. So it's the issue about, is their job still being done from home or not? I think it's going to be challenging for the public transport sectors to recover patronage, particularly the way that the rail network is set up to depend on significant numbers of city centre commuters paying premium fares. That's going to be really tough to recover. And indeed, I don't expect the level of city centre radio commuting to recover in the foreseeable future. So there are going to be ongoing questions about that. I really don't want to get into the issue of industrial action, because this is not my expertise, and I'm as much of an observer about the relationships between the rail industry employers and their employees as anybody else. And I say this as a member of a trade union in a profession which has its own issues with its own employers at the moment, so I understand that context very well. The one comment I'd make is that it's very instructive to look at the difference in conditions and the way that the sectors have been treated during COVID between the rail sector and between the bus sector in particular, and also between the rail sector and, again, other public services. So, for example, in the bus sector, many members of staff are furloughed. Wages tend to be lower. Employment tends to be more precarious. And there's been a long-standing debate, which I've participated in committees of this parliament and elsewhere, about whether the relative split in public support for bus versus rail is appropriate, given the vastly greater expenditure on the rail network for a much smaller relative contribution to overall transport needs. There'd be no furlough in the rail industry. There has been in bus. Wages, salaries tend to be much higher. I think that's one of the issues that's been exposed by this experience. And I'd also say that about comparisons between different public servants. So a ScotRail ticket examiner with 8 weeks training will earn the same salary as somebody entering the NHS in a professional nursing or midwifery or scientific job who's expected to have a degree. Now, there are lots of ways that you can look at that comparison. And one that I'd be entirely sympathetic to is that colleagues in our health service who've borne the brunt of this really terrible experience are underpaid. But I do wonder about the bringing in of the rail sector into the wider public expenditure conversation in a more explicit way than it's been in the past, and what the unintended consequences of that are going to be. So I suppose that's my semi-informed observer's opinion, to say that, yes, I really do hope that management and unions sit down and find a way through this, because I think this is a wider issue about how we make sure the finance of our key public services and the people that work in them is adequately and fairly agreed upon.
Thanks very much, Professor Doherty. We're going to move on to Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Liam Kerr. If I, just because we're up against the clock, if I could ask panel members to keep answers fairly brief. This is a fascinating topic, but we are slightly running against time. Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, convener, and welcome to the panel. I'm going to open up my question, if you don't mind, to any member of the panel who would like to answer it, and it's to do with the natural infrastructure. Can I ask, what are the key opportunities to not only increase natural infrastructure, but to also better integrate the planning, the investment and the delivery of natural infrastructure into the other forms of infrastructure planning? I'm not sure which one, if there's anybody would like to take that forward.
I can have a quick take on that one, in the absence of anyone else looking. I think one of the key opportunities is in the new National Planning Framework 4. On the back of the Infrastructure Commission's work, natural infrastructure was included in Scottish Government's definition of infrastructure, which is pretty monumental in terms of compared to lots of other countries around the world. So I think it's taking a good step and taking on board that. And the opportunity of the NPF4 provides for the first time that natural infrastructure to be considered in the context of everything else that's been looked at in the built environment. And so I think that does offer a really good opportunity for natural infrastructure to have a kind of level playing field and have its place in the way that Scotland plans its infrastructure going forward and fits that into wider policy making.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned NPF4. Can you maybe dig down a little bit deeper about what the key opportunity would be, do you think, for green and blue natural infrastructure within the framework?
Well, I guess on one level, having it on a level playing field with everything else within that context is an opportunity in itself, because it will be looked at in that same level, whereas it was relatively outside that system, I suppose, beforehand. So I do think just having it as part of the infrastructure definition and having it considered with transport and energy and others at that same level of importance is an opportunity in itself. And you know, it'd be interesting to see where MPF4 gets to in terms of bringing it into that fold.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Final question from Liam Kerr, please.
Very grateful, convener. Professor Turner, two questions for you, if I may. The Scottish Government signalled an intention to create a national public energy agency and has its remit a focus on heat, energy efficiency and delivery of investment. Is that the right place to focus rather than the traditional energy markets, do you think?
Well, I think so, yes, because I think there very much needs to be a focus on the service, how we're using the energy, because that's ultimately, you know, it determines the demand, you know, what people need and when they need it. But I think also it's the way to, you know, I think there's a lot in this debate about what is essential for different groups and what is luxury and things like that. And I think, you know, when we focus in on the types of services, particularly around heat, which is the big challenge that we've yet to make much ground with. You know, I think, you know, there's been important progress in energy efficiency and retrofitting with goals, you know, kind of perhaps with action to catch up. But I think this focus on the services, and I think, you know, government's role there, you know, the kind of public sector role there, and it really needs, again, to be on delivering the outcomes that are important for people and ensuring that different groups in society and the kind of the essential needs, you know, for those less able to pay continue to be met. So I think that is the right focus. I think we already have policy attention in terms of markets through the regulator and things like that. So it is very much, the interventions now need to be extremely well targeted given the scale of the challenge and limited time. So I think, yeah, the focus on service is important.
Very grateful. The final thing for me, in the papers that you supplied, you, Professor Turner, told us about your net zero principles framework for public policy making. One of those principles is, and I'm just going to read this, offshoring is not the answer in regional, national or global context if it only shifts emissions, jobs and GDP overseas. Now, that seems to me a very important point and indeed very important principles. How much regard do you know does the Scottish Government take to principles like this and indeed this framework?
But I think the problem is, and it's a big challenge, is that the targets that we are set, you know, kind of under the international climate agreements and you know, what's had to come through the Climate Act and things like that, they are territorial emissions. They are the emissions that are generated within Scotland and within the UK. And, you know, and if you take it to the extreme, the simplest way to reduce your emissions would just be to have all the dirty stuff not take place in Scotland. And I think, you know, kind of arguably, you know, this certainly came up through in the work of the Just Transition Commission. You know, things like there was a big drop in Scotland's emissions when the steel industry went. But in our consumption needs, we're still using steel indirectly every day. And it's very, very important. You know, even things like our wind farms, you know, they have a steel requirement, your cars and things like that. So there's this first high level issue that is very, we raised this issue through OECD negotiators and things like that, me and some other researchers more than 10 years ago, that are the targets we've got the right ones because they're territorial emissions. And I think the answer is they're the best we can get because it's taken so long to get everybody agreeing. And also it's very, very difficult if you went to like a carbon footprint measure to actually, you know, kind of measure things properly and consistently. But that doesn't mean to say we don't need to have an eye to what are the implications of what our decisions are. And the problem with, I think offshoring is probably the biggest risk. You know, there's a lot of debate around, you know, whether or not, you know, there's about new coal mines, whether or not we should be extracting oil and gas from the North Sea. The question for me is, are we still using it? You know, and if we are still indirectly using coal and oil and gas, but they're just being burned in other countries and extracted in other countries, that's not delivering climate justice, even though we might be meeting our targets. But the big offshoring concern, I guess, for society is that when we lose jobs here in order to clean, you know, meet Scotland's domestic territorial climate emissions. We're not only offshoring the emissions, it means that the jobs and the GDP generation are going somewhere else. So I think this needs to be central, because even though, strictly speaking, our targets are territorial ones, and Scotland will do well if it reaches net zero on that count, we need to always bear in mind, I think, the wider question of the global climate, even if we're not legally bound on that, but for the well-being of the Scottish people and the Scottish economy, it's the implications of we're not wanting to be protectionist. I think activity should take place at its most carbon-efficient location and things, but people's earnings and jobs, that's important, not just from a social sense, because if people lose jobs and earnings, we reduce our tax base, which means we don't have as much money to spend on net zero and other things. So it's really important that we're building a strong economy going forward that serves the people, as well as delivering in spirit, as well as in legal terms, on actually meeting the climate change problem. So offshoring, I think that needs to be front and centre, and also onshoring. If we can become a carbon efficient location with some of the first mover things we're doing, like the carbon capture and storage programmes, if we become the carbon efficient location, then maybe we could pull more production to this location. That'll become somebody else's offshoring problem, but that's the complexity of the problem, isn't it?
I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Liam, that brings us to the end of our allocated time. And let me thank once again our panel and guests this morning. You have given us a fascinating range of discussion points to take forward in our work programme. I wish we had longer, but that brings us to the end of our time. Thank you very much and enjoy the rest of your day. The final public agenda item for the committee is agenda item 3, which is consideration of negative instrument number 318 as listed on the agenda for the committee today. I refer members to paper number 3. This is an instrument laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul it. No motions to annul have been laid. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument on the 21st of September and determined that it did not need to draw the attention of Parliament to the instrument on any grounds within its remit. Do any members of the committee have comments on the instrument? There are no comments. I therefore invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. That is agreed. Thank you very much. The committee will now move into private session. Thank you.